Well, it's a big pleasure to close this conference with a talk by Roger Penrose on, from the University of Oxford on Twistor theory. So, please.
Well, I think I should start, as other people have done, thanking the organizers for inviting me to this meeting. But I think they deserve a particular thanks because I have this curious old-fashioned requirement of using a machine like this, which required moving furniture around and all sorts of things. People tell me I'm living in the last century, but that was not so long ago, so not so bad. I thought I would begin with some philosophical comments, because I think they're philosophical, because that was one of the requirements, I think. So I have to watch this carefully because it's upside down for me. I just wanted to make a distinction between the sort of aims, I think, of, well, PM, that means pure mathematics or pure mathematicians, and MP means mathematical physicists. Now, certainly very much at this meeting I've been aware that pure mathematicians are very much concerned, or a lot of them are at least, finding mathematical structures and procedures that are as general as possible. And they usually find they're not as general enough, and something else comes along more general. And I can see the reason for doing this. This is not a criticism. It's absolutely a very valuable thing. Whereas a mathematical physicist, in my view at least, makes use of such structures when they're available and when needed. But the task is to find particular ones rather than general things which are specific to the workings of nature. Now, I think a lot of mathematical physicists are really pure mathematicians too, who are looking at structures because they generalize ones they know about and not necessarily thinking they have a role to play in nature itself. But I think this is particularly, well, it's relevant, for example, when you're looking at, as an example, n-dimensional Riemannian manifolds and many of the more general spaces that people talk about, certainly at this meeting. Or in mathematical physics, I would say you're interested in four-dimensional Lorentzian manifolds. Lorentzian, that means with the space-time signature, one time in three space dimensions. Now, of course, a lot of physicists don't restrict themselves to this, but in my view, perhaps to some degree, they are adopting the pure mathematician point of view when they do that. I'm going to be talking about Twistor theory, and it is very much of the what I'm calling the MP philosophy. I'm very much concerned with, I mean, it's highly specific, I should say, to not just a four-dimensional space-time, but to space-time which has three dimensions of space and one dimension of time. There are versions of Twistor theory which don't depend on that specific number of dimensions, but they differ at some point in crucial ways. And the motivations to me are very much to do with this dimensionality. So let me make that clear, that it's perhaps an odd philosophy to a mathematician, because one's concerned often with generalizing structures, which is fine. But on the other hand, one of the strongest motivations in Twistor theory has been to pay attention specifically to the three dimensions of space and one of time. Now here I have a sort of cartoon of Twistor theory. On the left-hand side, I have a picture of what's going on in space-time. Minkowski space, so this is flat space-time. There's no gravity. It's three dimensions of space and one of time, but incorporated together. And we have these structures, the light cones, which are important, telling you the history of a light ray. Here we have a light ray, and you see that it's tangent to the light cones wherever it goes. So it's a straight line in the geometry, which is everywhere null. That means it's tangent to the light cones. Now, the space over here is, well, the first approximation to Twistor space, let's say. That's a space where the roles are somewhat reversed. The light ray is now represented by a single point, and the point here is represented by a sphere. You see, that's all the light rays through a point. And one of the basic motivations in Twistor theory is that this sphere can be thought of as a Riemann sphere. So this means it's a complex one-dimensional space. we're using, well, let me relate this picture. I'll bring this one back again and be a bit more specific about the correspondence. So here we have the correspondence indicated by these arrows, and this space here, we'll have four complex coordinates. We're concerned in this picture with the ratios of these four complex components. And the relationship between the four Minkowski coordinates over here and this is through this relation I call the incidence relation, which is at the bottom. If the incidence relation holds, on this side it means that the points represented by the coordinates in here lie on the line represented by the z's, and on this side it's the other way around. That is to say, the point lies on the this point lies on that. But if that point lies on that, this point lies on that. Now, there is an equation to this space here, which is given by this at the bottom. So that we have a Hermitian form, which has signature plus plus minus minus, a split signature form. And when that vanishes, then this correspondence does give you a light ray. So that is the basic Twistor correspondence. Now, as I say, there's a motivation here. I mean, you could do something like this in any number of dimensions. But the motivation here is that the sphere here can be thought of, as I said, as a Riemann sphere. Well, that is tied up with the fact that if you look at the sky, and here we have a space-time picture of the past light cone of a point here, and the light rays, if you have different observers looking out, they're moving at different speeds, then they will see a different sphere, but the relationship between this sphere and that sphere, that is to say the two spheres of the two observers, is that it's conformal. So also circles here go to circles here. So if you have four stars which happen to lie on a circle, they will lie on a circle to the other observer as well. And this feature is encapsulated if you think of the sphere here as a one-dimensional complex manifold, in other words, a Riemann sphere. Now this is also the other part of physics, that's relativity, which we're talking about there. But the, whoopsie daisy, now there's a catastrophe here. Maybe. Yes, this table is not quite big enough, is it? No, there we shall, I shall have problems. I should do this the other way around, shouldn't I? If I put this up here. Yeah, but I may have got things a bit out of order. Can you see everything down there? I'll keep that ready for when I need it. Thank you. That's okay, I think. Yep.
There's nothing else.
Nothing else down there. Okay. I hope it's not a catastrophe. We'll have to see. Okay. Excuse me a minute. Yep. Yes, the other role for the Riemann sphere comes from quantum mechanics, and this is, if you want to consider, say, the spin directions of a spin half particle like an electron, it's the superposition of two states, and these can be state up, spin up and spin down, and that gives you a general state, but it's very geometrical. That is to say, the state of spin is pointing in a direction which is related to the Riemann sphere of the ratio of these two complex numbers. So if U is Z over W, and that's the ratio of these two amplitudes, which are the complex numbers here, then U is represented as a point on the complex plane here, and you can project stereographically from the South Pole to this point here, and then the distance out from the origin gives you the direction of spin. So you have a nice geometrical representation of this very basic fact in quantum mechanics, that you have these complex amplitudes and complex projective line of ratios between those two numbers is also given by this sphere, and that is geometrically the same as the sphere that we're talking about in relativity. And so there you see it exhibited as a Riemann sphere directly. So the point is that there is this, well, some people call it a pun, but it's striking that the only dimension in signature where you get this complex manifold structure to the rays through the origin in the light cone is in 3 plus 1 dimensions. So it's a specific feature for 3 plus 1 dimensions. But I want to try and carry that further. And the idea is, well, first of all, in this correspondence which I've just described, there is an issue. We needed this form down at the bottom. The space of light rays is five-dimensional, and the philosophy here is to try and carry the complex structure that you get for the space of light rays, it's a complex projective line, further. And this, I should say, is a driving idea behind Twistor theory, is that somehow holomorphic things are important. Complex analytic structure is a vital thing, and that maybe the laws of physics are controlled somehow by the magic of complex numbers. It's something which I got very much influenced by when I was an undergraduate, learning about the very wonderful things and properties that complex numbers have, and feeling that somehow they ought to be at the basis of the way the world operates. And that's something which is very much a driving force behind Twistor theory. Whether you call that philosophy or not, I'm not sure, but it's certainly a driving force. Now, the thing is that this space being five-dimensional, I would like to think it is a complex manifold as a whole. If it's got things in it which are complex manifolds, it would be nice for the whole thing to be a complex manifold. But you're in trouble right from the start because the space is five-dimensional, and five is an odd number, and so it can't be a complex manifold. It would have to be real. In terms of real dimensions, it would have to be an even number. However, and here's something which is rather miraculous, and that is that this space of light rays is actually naturally extendable to, with one more dimension, to become what I'm calling, well, this is projective Twistor space. It's a complex projective three space. And this, if you like, is the space, I gave you these coordinates a minute ago, the z's, and if you think of those coordinates as the ratios of them as the coordinates for this projective space, that's exactly what you have here. So that is this correspondence extending naturally into a complex manifold. There is more to it than that, which is a physical thing. And let me just see what I've said at the bottom, having to read it upside down. I've said all these points here, so there's a lot to say, so let me not spend too much time on these things here. But I do want to say something about what one plays with often is not just the projective space, but the non-projective space. So these are what I'm calling non-projective twisters. That's the coordinates. The z coordinates would give you a point in this vector space, and the vector space, you see, it's factored out by these rays through the origin here, and we now talk about twisters as being the elements of this vector space. Now, one of the slightly miraculous things here is that you do get an interpretation for the points which lie outside the light ray space. There's a top half and a bottom half, and these correspond to positive helicity, right-handed massless particles. This is all classical for the moment. I'm not talking about quantum mechanics. And these ones for the negative helicity, the left-handed particles. And I have a sort of cartoon of what's going on here. The ones in the top half are spinning right-handed. The ones in the bottom half are spinning left-handed. So that's the physical interpretation of what's going on. Now, everything I've said up to this point has to do with flat space. So this is Minkowski space. Now, what I want to get to in this lecture, I hope, at the end, is what you do. It's a major problem which has been sitting around for a long time. How do you develop a Twistor theory for a general curved space-time? Now, what it turns out, there's a thing which I call the googly problem, which has been involved in this a long time. I'll come to that later. But it's been holding this up for about half a century. The problem has been lying around, and all sorts of partial answers to this, none of which really worked, have come up from time to time. Now, I want to try and present to you, at the end of the talk, what I think is the answer. And this is in terms of what I'm calling palatial Twistor theory. I'm not going to go into the reason we call it palatial, but let's think of it as something which is a palace in some way. And in order to describe the general Lorentzian globally hyperbolic, Lorentzian, it's four-dimensional, one-time free space. Globally hyperbolic, well, that basically means you can get it from the whole space, from the evolution of a three-dimensional space-like surface, if you like. There are lots of other definitions of what it means. It's not essential for what I want to say, but it makes it easier. And the thing is that you get a Twistor space, which is a non-commutative geometry. Now, this really does seem to be what you get. And I have been pretty frightened of the idea, and we heard about non-commutative geometry earlier today, and other people haven't been so frightened of it as I have, but mainly because I can't see how to draw pictures and things in it and so on. But I think it may be largely a question of getting used to the ideas and seeing how to do it. But this does seem to be where one is led. And the reason one is led there is something which I shall try and give some indication of in the talk. But it does seem to me, although some of these things are conjectural, I don't know, I don't have all the theorems we need, but I'm trying to express the idea, which I do think, that this non-commutative Twistor theory is in fact the solution to this problem. I'm not doing quantum mechanics at this stage, I should say. Quantum mechanics, one has non-commuting operators and things like that, and it's relevant, very relevant, but this is not quantum gravity. At the very end, I will make some comments which I do think could well have something to do with quantum gravity, but this is classical space-time geometry. I'm not even deviating at all from the notion of a Lorentzian space-time, a classical space-time, and how does one form a Twistor space for that Lorentzian space-time, and that's the object of the game. Now, before trying to do that, I'm going to have to say quite a bit about the conventional Twistor theory, which I can call it, I suppose, which we've been playing around with for a long time. And to a geometer, I suppose one of the easiest ways of thinking that about twisters is the Klein correspondence, which it is, basically. Here we have a quadric, which is a four-quadric in an ambient projective five space, and think of it as complex, and it has these two-dimensional planes in it of two kinds, which are called alpha planes and beta planes. And according to the Klein representation, we have this being the representation of projective subspaces, sublinear projective spaces in the three-dimensional projective space. So the points are represented by the points of this quadric. The lines are represented, I'm so sorry, the lines in the space are represented by the points of the quadric. The points and the planes are respectively represented by the alpha planes and the beta planes in that quadric. So this is the Klein correspondence. And usually one's looking at it the other way around. You're saying, how do we represent this space in terms of some other geometric structure? But I'm regarding this as the space-time, and this is the Twistor space associated with it. If everything is complexified and compactified, so you need to put something in its infinity, which I'll say something about, to make this correspondence work completely, you need... See, here I have a plane representing infinity, so that if you cut that... the intersection... See, it looks like two lines, but it's really a cone here. If you take that away, that represents infinity, then the remainder of that space is conformally the same as Minkowski space. And that's the way one does it. You can introduce these ideal elements at infinity to give you a more complete picture. And the incidence is simply represented here. A point on a line is going by here. The point lying on a line is the line lying on a... Let's say the red one is the alpha plane, and the green one is the point on it here. And in this case, the plane is represented by a beta plane here, and this is the line lying on the beta plane is a plane lying through the point, going through the point. And then in the Minkowski geometry, you have two points lying on a null direction, so this would be actually the intersection of an alpha plane and a beta plane. That's what we're doing here, and that is what a null geodesic or a straight line in a light ray in this space would be, have both an alpha plane and a beta plane through it. So it's represented by a point lying on a plane here. Anyway, that's the geometry, and you could, it's easier to follow through and see what's going on. I should also give you the case when one doesn't have Minkowski space. I should say that the whole structure, Twistor structure, is conformally invariant. So you're not really concerned with the metric of space-time, but you're concerned with light rays and the incidence properties of light rays, and all that is conformal, Lorentzian conformal geometry. We now believe that cosmologically there is a cosmological constant, which means that on a very, very large scale, space-time is rather like de Sitter space and not Minkowski space, and that really just means that this plane, its infinity, isn't a tangent plane. It's more general than that. In each case, you have a quantity, a two-index Twistor, which is a skew, so it's a... Well, if I've got them upstairs, it's a dual two-form. And if that's simple, in other words, its determinant vanishes, then that gives you the Minkowski case. But if the scalar product of infinity twisted with its dual is positive, you get de Sitter space. If it's negative, you get anti-de Sitter space. So these things are of interest cosmologically, and the case where it's positive are the ones which seem to correspond with the observation. So that's of relevance to things that I will say right at the end. Now, in order to do calculations, and this is where people usually get confused, because the calculations that are useful in this subject depend on the two-spinner notation. Now, I'm going to give you some calculations with two-spinner notation, but I'm not going to ask you to follow them. I'm just going to point to things and saying, oh, this is the equation for such and such. So I don't have time to go into it anyway. But the basic idea is that in standard tensor notation, when you're not a mathematician but you like to use indices, these would be tensor indices, but you split each of these into two, and these become spinner indices. I won't go into the notation here. A point that I would like to make, which is quite important here, is that I shall be concerned a lot with two spinners. And a two spinner, here I have this thing psi is a two spinner, and if you multiply it by its complex conjugate, you've got one index and one with a prime, and this gives you an ordinary tensor index. This is actually a vector, and it's necessarily a null vector, so it points along the light cone, so that the two-spinner corresponds to a null vector, but it doesn't just do that. If you look at it a bit more carefully, you see that the phase, there's a phase multiplier of this thing, which can be interpreted as what we think of as a flag plane to it. This is the null two-plane, and the best thing for visualizing it is think of a section through this cone, which is really a two-sphere, and the null ray will meet it in the point, and then there is a tangent vector to the two-sphere here, which gives you the phase. So that can rotate round, and as that rotates round, the phase goes, well, it's a spinner, so you have to go around twice. If you go all the way around once, the spinner becomes its negative. You go around again, and it becomes back to where it was before. So it's useful to bear in mind that there is a geometrical interpretation of the phase, which is completely there, geometrical, up to a sign. To get the sign right, you have to worry a little bit about non-local things, but that's a point that we will come back to us later on. Okay. Now I want to say more about the what twisters mean and how you do it. I have the incidence relation, and this is it just written down again. These things here, I'm using R's, I think. These are the orange ones, if you can see them, are the space-time coordinates, and the Z's, the blue ones, are the Twistor coordinates. And this is the incidence relation, which gives you the relationship between the two geometries. But I'm going to write these two components here as a single spinner. That's omega, and these two is a single spinner, which I'll call pi. I'm not sure I've got a picture of it here, but the pi is the direction of the light ray with the flag plane as well, and the omega is, roughly speaking, the moment of that light ray about the origin. So they have clear-cut geometrical interpretations. So the whole Z, the Twistor, can be thought of as a pair, one of which is the omega and the other the pi. The pi the letter pi is used because it's related to p, which is the momentum, and I'll come to that in a minute. Omega is a letter often used for angular momentum, so that's the moment about the origin that is involved here. More specifically, I'll come to that in just a minute. Here we have what we do. If you move the origin, the pi's remain the same, whereas the omegas get a bit of pi added into it. And the complex conjugate of a twister, you have to reverse these order of these two and complex conjugate them each. The rule is that the indices become primed if they weren't before, and they become unprimed if they were before. So when you swap them around, this thing is a dual object to this. And so this has a natural scalar product with this, and that scalar product, when it vanishes, is the condition that it should be a null twister. That lies on the space Pn, which I had the Hermitian form for before. That this is, in fact, the Hermitian form written in this notation here. That, and the vanishing of it is what you have for that the light ray space. Now, and here is a more complete physical interpretation. I said that the pi was a momentum thing. The momentum is p, that's the usual letter people use for momentum. It's naturally actually a covector, which would have its index downstairs. It's null, so its scalar product with itself is zero. It points into the future, so there's two conditions you must have on the p. The angular momentum, well, I'll come to that in a minute. There's a thing called the Pauli-Lubansky spin vector, which is this thing S, and that is, well, you need to know what this is first. This is the angular momentum. The angular momentum in relativity is a six-component object. This has got its skew in A and B. It's a dual bivector, but it's a bivector. And the thing is that it has to satisfy this condition that when you contract the momentum in with it, you get something which is proportional to the momentum. This is a special feature that massless particles have. This proportionality factor is a thing called a helicity. And all these rather complicated conditions are encompassed in this very sort of notation of the omegas and pi. Once you have a definition of what m is, which I've given down here, the round brackets mean skew symmetry, the epsilon quantity is a skew symmetrical object. The p, you see, this is the product I mentioned before. If you multiply the pi with its complex conjugate, you get a vector. This is an outer product. It gets a vector. And this is the momentum vector. But there's an additional phase which is contained in the pi, and the omega is then, if you know what pi is, then the omega is fixed by this relation to the angular momentum. And it's completely, goes backwards and forwards, it's complete equivalence. So long as the pi is not zero, then this structure and this structure are equivalent. The helicity here, which is rather complicatedly defined, turns out to be just half the scalar product here. So the helicity is half the twister norm. Okay, don't worry about the details of the equations, but this just shows that, in fact, the twisters have a very clear physical interpretation, even though they may be the null ones. So that was the picture I was showing you earlier. Here we have this correspondence, and here we have, you actually need the scaling, so you're in the non-projective twister space. I think that's there, somewhere in here. But if you're in the top half, that helicity S is positive, bottom half helicity is negative. The helicity is zero, you get a light ray. If the helicity is not zero, and if you know the angular momentum and the momentum and all that, you can't use that to locate a light ray. It's non-local. So particles which have no mass and an angular momentum, an intrinsic angular momentum, are in a sense non-localized. So these things don't have a local light ray description. And that's indicated here that the points up here don't immediately give you a light ray. They're spread out in some sense. Okay, this is all classical. There's nothing mysterious about it. It's just what happens. Okay. Now, I want to go a little more in the direction of quantum theory, and there are lots of reasons for doing that. This is what I'm calling the first quantized twister theory, or quantum twister theory, that the these things, like with position and momentum in quantum mechanics, classically they are thing commuting variables. Now I'm going to make the twisters and their complex conjugates things which don't commute. The twister components all commute with themselves, but they don't commute with their complex conjugates. And this is all pretty well equivalent when you write things in terms of m's and p's, of x's and p's. You find that these are more or less equivalent to the quantization rules for position and momentum, but not quite. There's a little bit extra which you get here, which has to do with helicity. But it's a very natural thing to write down these commutation rules. And in fact, when you do that, and you now put these into the definition I had before for the angular momentum, you do find that you retrieve the normal commutation rules between momentum and angular momentum, which correspond to the motions of the infinitesimal motions of the Poincaré group. So you have the translations and the angular, the things with rotation over here. And the correct commutation rules here, which are all quite complicated, come about from the, I guess I've got them written down here. These are the commutation rules that we have, standard commutation rules for position, for the angular momentum and momentum. And these are much more easily seen as simply what I've written down here. So the twisters give you that directly. Okay. Now, suppose I was trying to do quantum theory of particles or something in terms of twisters. What would I do, bearing in mind these commutation rules? Well, I would say, okay, as with ordinary particle quantum mechanics, you say, well, you can take a position representation or you can take a momentum representation. If you take a position representation, the momentum will be derivatives with respect to position. If you take a momentum representation, then the positions will be derivative with respect to momentum. So that's the kind of rule you get. And that, of course, satisfies the normal commutation rules. What happens in twister theory? Well, in twister theory, you can think of using what I call twister function, which is the wave function in twister notation. If you choose the z variables, and I'll usually do it that way around, you could choose one or the other, but let's choose the z variables, then what you're going to say is your wave function should be, as in ordinary quantum mechanics, something which depends on one of the variables and not in the conjugate variable. So it's got to be a function of z and not of z bar. Well, what does that mean? Because z bar depends on z. No. What it means, independent of z bar, means partial d by dz bar equals naught. In other words, holomorphic. So you automatically get, from this quantization perspective and twister theory, you get your wave functions should be holomorphic functions. Okay. Now, you also might be interested in helicity eigenstates. So if you're looking at, say, wave functions of photons, that would be where the helicity is 1 or minus 1. If you were doing helicity of, a zero spin particle, then the helicity S would be 0. If it was for a spin half, say a neutrino, if it were massless, then you would have S would be plus or minus a half. If it were a graviton and you're just looking at linear theory, then you would have S would be plus or minus 2. The helicity, well, you see, what does ZZ bar mean? A bit hard for me to see this upside down, but never mind. ZZ bar is ZD by DZ, and D by DZ is ZD by DZ is the Euler operator. So the eigenstates of this thing are going to be homogeneous functions. So if you're looking at particles of a fixed helicity, plus or minus being taken into account, then you are looking for holomorphic functions which were not only not only holomorphic, but they are also homogeneous. And the homogeneity degree S is related to that by this formula here. So it's, you find that the, I don't know if I wrote it, I must have written it down somewhere. Yes, here we had it down here. Let me go back to that. See, previously S was a half of ZZ bar, but you have to take into account the non-commutation between these things. There's no problem with the commutation rules in the definition of M. Everything cancels out. There are no problems with factor ordering. The only factor ordering issue comes in with S, and it has to be this polarized form, ZZ bar plus Z bar Z, which means that the homogeneity degree is shifted from the helicity according to this formula here. So there's the homogeneity degree, and S is equal to Planck's constant over 2 times minus 2 minus this homogeneity degree. I'll tend to put H bar equal to 1. Some of my slides it may put equal to 1, others it may not be. It depends which ones I've chosen to show here. But just imagine it's 1. It will be 1 in all the things I do here. Okay, so there we are. Now, just to see what this does in particular examples, let me just see, I'm getting myself confused here. Yeah. Suppose you were looking at wave functions in a more conventional framework, space-time notation, and it would be convenient to use two-component spinners because we've got half integer spin as well as integer spin. And the general way of doing this is basically Dirac did all this. You would have a spinner with n indices, the spin being half the number of indices. And if they're all unprimed, that would be left-handed. If they're all primed, that would be right-handed. And there is this, if there are no indices, it's just the wave operator, which is your Schrodinger equation, if you like. If the spin is non-zero, then you have this very simple Dirac operator acting on the on the field. So you have these field equations. Now the thing is that in the Twistor form, you simply have a homogeneity degree. If you're using the Zs, let's see. This, I think I've just got it written here. That's right. This in this column is the actual helicity, and this column is the homogeneity degree. You can see it's a little bit crazy looking. If it's a spinless particle, the homogeneity degree is minus 2. If you're working with a photon, you'd get either 0 for the left-handed or minus 4 for the right-handed. If it was a linear spin 2 massless particle, you could call a graviton, then it would be plus 2 or minus 6. And it's curious, you have this huge discrepancy between the homogeneity degrees. And this is one of the things which has caused problems for a long time. And I'll come to why that is a problem. It's not a particular problem here. Before going on to how you see the relationship between the Twistor function and these field equations, let me just explain how it relates to the Maxwell equations. In the one case, if you put these fields here, this is the right-handed part, that's the left-handed part. You put in some epsilons, which are given free. This is the self-dual part of the Maxwell field and the anti-self-dual part. This is the self-dual part, that's the anti-self-dual part, sorry. I'm looking at it upside down and it all is confusing to me. But it's this thing that describes the anti-self-dual part and this the self-dual part. I think I have it right. And in the case of gravity, one has 4 indices and you need a couple of epsilons to make it into a tensor. And you've got these two parts too, the anti-self-dual and self-dual parts. And this gives you a thing with 4 indices which have Riemann tensor symmetries, but where all the traces vanish. This is actually the symmetries of a Weyl conformal tensor. And that can be used to describe the degrees of freedom of the gravitational field. And these are also conformally invariant equations, I should say, where you have to, I won't go into this in detail, but you simply multiply the phis by omega to the minus 1, and the equations are invariant. Okay, now, what is the relation between these equations, and they would include Maxwell equations, and the weak field Einstein equations. They are given here most directly by a contour integral. I should explain that for wave functions, you would be interested in things which have positive frequency. I don't have time to go into all this here. But what it means is that you're looking at things to do with the top half of Twistor space, and that requires that the thing be, or gives you positive frequency. The lines in the top half correspond to what's called the forward tube, and if the field exists in the top half, you're going to have positive frequency field, and that's what you want for a wave function. But let's not worry too much about that. This is just a specific example where I've chosen the massless case, the spinless case. So this is just a solution of the wave equation, and the most basic Twistor function you can use has got to be homogeneity degree minus 2, so you might as well put two linear factors on the bottom. Those linear factors, A times X, A dot Z equals 0, B dot Z equals 0, give you planes in Twistor space, and this is where the singularities are of this. These singularities are arranged so that the regions come together in the bottom half, so they're always separated in the top half, and then your lines in the top half intersect in separated points, and then you can do a contour integral, and that gives you a well-defined field. The point is that you automatically get the wave equation out from the homogeneity and holomorphicness of the function. And this applies to higher spins, where you have to put in a lot of pi's in if the helicity is positive, and if the helicity is negative, you put a lot of d by d omegas in. Notice that here you have an indication also of the quantization procedure, because if you take the complex conjugate of one of these, you should get one of these, but the complex conjugate would give you something which is not holomorphic. So to make it holomorphic, you've got to translate back into these differential operators, which is the first quantization rule. So you could see that the quantization rule is coming in here, even if we're not really, well, we're doing a bit of quantum mechanics because we're looking at wave functions, if you like, but not very much of it. So that's the way these contour integrals work. But then you say, well, what are we really doing? I used to worry about this for a long time because it seemed to me very unnatural that you should have these planes sticking up here, which aren't where the thing is singular. And more generally, these could spread out into big camel humps. And that's a little bit funny because what are they doing? And discussions with Michael Attia eventually made it clear that what we'd be doing was first cohomology. In fact, that is exactly what's going on here. You can take coverings of just two sets, which is the camel hump situation. I should say that is, if you've just got one Twistor function, then it's singular on two such regions like this. And then you take the top half is covered by a set which leaves out one cover hump and another set which leaves out the other one. The intersection is where the function is defined, and the quantity you're interested in is really on the whole thing. Well, that's cohomology. And if you could take a covering with loads and loads of sets, and then you do contour integrals, which are more complicated, if you like, but it's all cohomology. I won't go into the details of this, because I'm sure you know it a lot better than I do, but we end up with the cohomological representation of wave functions in Twistor theory, which, once you've mastered the idea of cohomology, is really extraordinarily simple. What you're talking about is the complex cohomology of the top half of Twistor space, and that is simply the wave functions of massless fields. The wave functions of massless fields are simply described in this formalism by the first cohomology of the top half of Twistor space. You don't have to be talking about the top half, you can talk about other regions if you like, and you can talk about solutions of Maxwell's equations classically, or linearized gravity classically. And this simply is a very neat way of encompassing that information. And it does it for all spins at once. So it is very convenient. Now, you have to, if you've got wave functions, you're going to want scalar products and making a Hilbert space out of it. I should just indicate this because this is very, it's interesting that these things raise all sorts of questions, and that it seems to shift when you go from one helicity to another. And it's an interesting problem. This is basically the answer to it eventually, which is a formula due to Andrew Hodges, which works for all the helicities. I'm not going to go into it here, but it does show you can define the scalar product by means of a contour integral which has two parts to it. Depending on the helicities, you may need only one part or the other, but to express everything together, he has this expression here, which is either a straightforward contour integral using an exponential here. I should say it's a contour integral with a boundary, and the boundary is in the vanishing of the scalar product between the two variables here, W and Z. The W's, I should say, are dual twisters. The Z's are twisters. And over here we have the other part, where you have to do a K integral and so on. I won't go into that. I just want to indicate there is such an expression, and that it does realize the relationship between the complex conjugate and the twister. So the partial derivative with respect to the complex conjugate is basically the twister, and that's part of the computation rules. It's true the other way around too, but I didn't want to write everything down. And it just, you can see that the scalar product formula is somehow this relationship, twister quantization rule, is hidden in there. Now, that's all linear. And seems to me quite, you know, remarkable enough that you can express these, all these massless field equations. Certainly if we write them in tensor form, they look very, very complicated. Spinner form, they don't look complicated, but the fact that you can, it is really just talking about the cohomology of twister space, or of part of twister space, is a rather remarkable thing. Certainly something that comes out, it wasn't put in at the beginning. However, it's more. One can go more and talk about nonlinear things. The first example was the what I call the nonlinear graviton. Let me come to that in a minute. But shortly afterwards, Richard Ward, who was a student of mine, saw how to do gauge fields. And you can use the... This is now genuine cohomology in a sense. Well, it's nonlinear. You're looking at a bundle. And you make a bundle, and you can do the Yang-Mills. I should say this is only for the negative helicity case. So you're looking at helicity minus 1 in the case of the Yang-Mills or Maxwell fields, and minus 2 in the case of gravity. Let's talk about gravity, because that's really what I want to talk about here. You see, the cohomology you can think of as deformations of the twister space. So you can patch together bits of flat twister space where the... On the intersection, you imagine an infinitesimal deformation, which would be a vector field, where you slide one patch a little bit away from the other one, or along the other one. And this vector field is defined very naturally from a homogeneity plus 2 twister function. And so you can see that the cohomology represents very naturally this infinitesimal deformation of the twister space itself. And... by a finite deformation, not just an infinitesimal one, you actually get the genuine full Yang-Mills equations or the genuine full Einstein equations, but only in the anti-self-dual case. So you're looking at negative helicity. I forget which is which now. One helicity. And just to indicate how the construction works for general relativity... this is general relativity without a cosmological constant. It doesn't make much difference. You can put one in too. The thing is, here you have the relationship which you had before. Here is Minkowski space over here. Here is a piece of twister space. Usually it's a tubular neighborhood of a line if you want to make sure it works globally. It works globally in that tubular neighborhood. And what you find is there is a structure to this space here, which is non-local. Locally, it looks just like the flat twister space. There's a non-local structure which encodes the... Well, in Minkowski space, it's just the construction I gave you before. But if you deform this, let's take a tubular neighborhood of a line, and then what I'm going to do is deform this tubular neighborhood by cutting it into two pieces. See, this is really... The topology is all in the line, which is really a sphere. So this is a two-sphere here. And that two-sphere is now going to be cut into two overlapping pieces, and this tubular neighborhood is also in two overlapping pieces. Then I shunt one with respect to the other and glue it back together again. Now, of course, the line now is broken, but according to nice theorems, Kodaira theorems tell us that if you're not too far away, at least you can still find another line, which is defined by being in the same homology class as this line, about which is not obtained by breaking it. Of course, that's cheating, but it's actually holomorphic. And the holomorphic nature restricts it, and there are a four-dimensional family of these holomorphic lines. Therefore, the space of these lines is a complex manifold which has four dimensions. You can define what you mean by null separation by the intersection between two such lines. This gives you a conformal structure. It's a complex conformal structure. and so you can construct manifolds with a non-flat conformal structure. However, well, let me go back to this picture. You can also see the metric on it by seeing the structure. I can come back to this later in a more general situation. But the fact that it's got this means if you preserve this structure here, you actually get the Einstein equations. So you can represent the general, what can we call left-handed, complex solution of the Einstein vacuum equations, that is zero cosmological constant, or even with a positive cosmological constant or negative one, you can do them all, by simply looking at deformed Twistor spaces. The deformation can be carried out with free functions. It's easy to see. The only difficulty comes in finding where these lines are. So it's not a completely trivial problem to find all the solutions, and you may not know where these lines are. In special cases, one can find them, and it's a very nice way of representing all the solutions of the Einstein vacuum equations, complex solutions, which are anti-self-dual, and this construction does it. Now, that's been around us for a long time, I don't know, 40 or 50 years now, and this is what I call the googly problem. Now, those people who have nothing to do with the former British Empire probably have no idea what a googly is, but a googly is a cricket ball which is bowled with an action which makes it look right-handed, where it actually spins right-handed. So it's exactly what one's trying to do here. In the framework, which naturally gives you left-handed, how do you do right-handed? So we call that the googly problem, and that's what it is. Left-handed, etc. Okay, now I've told you what the googly problem is. And it's been sitting around for ages. And I had all sorts of ideas about how to solve it one way or another. They almost always meant doing something which I completely didn't understand what I was doing, or by going off to infinity where the structure is simpler and you can split it down and then bring yourself back to finite regions. It didn't seem to me that was really the right way of doing it, although that's what I did for many decades, I would say. And it was only in the last few years that a different idea of how to solve this googly problem came about. Now, I'm going to tell you what this different idea is in sort of general terms. I've probably already run out of time, but 10 minutes. Okay, that's fine. I can give you the general idea. Unlike the case for the negative velocity case, where we have wonderful theorems, and Michael Atiyah particularly drove us in the right direction, we Kodaira theorems and so on, and we know it works. And it's genuine mathematics. This case, we don't know yet. I think it does work, but I don't have the theorems. Let's just tell you what the idea is to take the Twistor quantization procedure seriously. Remember that in the flat Twistor theory, one had complex conjugate of a Twistor is in a certain sense minus the derivative with respect to the Twistor. And if you think of it this way, you're still in the holomorphic world. So this was always important to me. Stay in the holomorphic world, and you get these wonderful theorems. And this is part of the general, well, if I can call it philosophy, the philosophy of Twistor theory is to stay as much as you can in the holomorphic world. And then you get theorems which may drive you in the way you want. Now, the idea then here is that the holomorphic world means you're replacing your z's by d by dz's. And so the idea is that somehow, when you're trying to piece manifolds together in just the same way as I did before, basically two pieces enough to do what we did before, but you're not actually piecing manifolds together, you're piecing together the Twistor, what you might call the Heisenberg algebra here. So you've got this non-commutative algebra here, and that is to be matched with the non-commutative algebra over here. And this is just a crude picture of what's going on, very crude, because I don't know how to draw it, that you've got some... the picture I have is that you want coordinates over here and coordinates over here, and what you would have done in the old case was to take coordinates, and these would be on the overlap region, these would be ordinary transition functions. So these coordinates would be ordinary holomorphic functions of these ones. They'd have to be homogeneous, of the right degree, and that's fine. So these would be homogeneous degree one functions of these, and the inverse is likewise the other way around. But now we don't have the manifold down here, and how do we do it? Well, we have to do it with a non-commutative geometry. If you had a commutative geometry, then you'd be able to find the points here, and this wouldn't get you anything new. So you do a non-commutative geometry, and somehow you match the geometries. So the picture I have, at least in the very simplest case, would be that in this patch, I mean, you have a sort of global non-commutative geometry, which applies to the whole space, but you can realize that as, well, in quantum mechanical language, you'd find a complete set of commuting variables. So with things you would think of as your Twistor variable Z on this side, and then another set, X's instead on this side, and the Z's wouldn't be functions of X's, they would be the Z's and the D by DZ's would be functions of the X's and the D by DX's when you go over here. Now I have great problems with some of this because I like to think I know what I'm doing with the topology, and I like to know what open sets mean and when I'm in a neighborhood and so on and so forth. And so I get very confused when I'm in this non-commutative setup. Nevertheless, I think something like this works. And in order to explain where I think we are in this subject, I'm afraid these slides are a little bit packed with words, but maybe you like the words better than the pictures, I don't know. The thing is to go back to the null ray space, which does exist. If I'm talking about a Lorentzian space-time, then I can talk about the light rays, just as I did before. The light ray space, I'm calling it Pn, where the P means projective, and the N represented, I think if you have a good memory, you might recall that I think I used the notation Pn for my original Twistor picture, which, yes, I believe I did. That's right. It was an upright N here because this was a non-curved case. This was a canonical case. But if this space now gets curved, still Lorentzian, so you still have light cones, you still have light rays, these being null geodesics now, this point is still now representing that light ray, and we still have, in a certain sense, Riemann spheres representing the light rays through a specific point. But we don't have a complex structure here, and you can see from the geometrical meaning of the complex structure that once you have conformal curvature over here, it's going to get wrecked. So the complex structure is certainly not going to persist here, not if it's just a manifold. But the complex structure, well, things do persist. The curly N now means that you're just working with a general space-time manifold. I'm not saying Einstein equations or anything, just a general space-time manifold. I am going to assume that it's 4 plus 1 dimensions and that it's globally hyperbolic, which is handy. Now, if you put a momentum scaling on this, so here is my light ray, and I now give it a strength by having a momentum, well, really a covector, pointing along here, which the size of that momentum vector gives you the frequency or the momentum of that photon running along there. Now, the space of these momentum-scaled light rays is a symplectic manifold, and you can write this in ordinary P's and X's. These are two different dimensional, reductions, symplectic reductions well, let's not go into the details of that, but you can write it with Twistor coordinates too. And this will be the sort of form which I tend to be thinking in terms of. So the Pn is a symplectic manifold. Now the symplectic manifold, what I'm going to try and do is apply as a first step the procedures of geometric quantization, or at least it's really a pre-quantization to this symplectic manifold. And the procedures require that for the symplectic manifold, I find a circle bundle over the symplectic manifold, and then I find a connection whose curvature is this two form. So the sigma form will be the curvature of the connection that you get from the pre-quantization procedure. Well, actually, you can do this very explicitly, and it's very geometrical, and I'm not going to say it here, but it's perfectly clear, and you can do it. A point I would like to mention, though, is that this circle bundle, in just this case, if I were working in higher dimensions, then a lot of this formalism would apply just as well. But the thing which is very specific to 3 plus 1 dimensions is that the circle bundle is already there given to you. The circle bundle is, in fact, the phase of the pi spinner. So if I think of this not as momentum scaled, but as spinner scaled, then that is the circle bundle. So that I get this thing n without any p's on it. It's a little p if I put a momentum scaling on it. Big p if it's just the light ray. Momentum scaling is a little p. And no p at all if it is the spinner scaled version. So that is the 7-dimensional space n that we already had in the flat Twistor case, but now we have a curved Twistor space. Now, that's the first step. And what I want to try and do here is to try and think of this space N as the common boundary between two non-commutative regions. You see, these are genuinely non-commutative spaces because the d by dz's, if you like, are our coordinates. If I take a coordinate patch, I can use z's, but the z bars are now d by dz's. And so it's a non-commuting thing. And I can take local regions where I can find a complete set of what in quantum mechanics you call a complete set of commuting variables, and then you can pretend those are the z's, and so on. But you can do that locally. This so far has not contained any of the information of the space-time. You see, the space N has a nice symplectic structure, but it doesn't know where the points are. You see, the points of the space that it came from are certain spheres in this space. But just this symplectic structure doesn't know anything about those things. So you've got to encode the information of that. And the key way of doing that, apparently, is to use what's called local twisted transport. Well, I say here, see the next slide, so I'm going to bring that up, but it's in the middle of a sentence almost over there. But let me bring the local twisted transport up. This is a conformally invariant connection on a local twister. A local twister is, if you like, locally a pair omega and pi, which have to scale appropriately under conformal scalings, which I think I have here. Yeah. Yes, that's it down there. That is the conformal scaling. And then there is a transport along a curve. I can take a local twister along a curve by the formula given here, which involves the curvature of the space. But taken all together, this is a conformally invariant transport. So the whole procedure is actually conformally invariant. So it doesn't depend on the metric, it just depends on the conformal class. However, if the space, if the space is conformally flat, it's also integrable. I can go around a loop and get back to where I started, at least if it's a contractible loop, I can go and get back to where I started. However, if there is genuine conformal curvature present, then you will not get back to where you started. Now, it does happen to be the case, however, that when you go along the null geodesic, it mucks up the z's and z-bars, but in a way which preserves the commutation rule. So the commutation rule is respected by the local twister transport. I'm not sure what I've actually said in my slide here. I can't see very well up there. but anyway, it preserves this commutation rule. But it's really only a sort of local thing. You've got... let me just see what I've got in here. I had a picture earlier on, which I think I was trying to find, but it's probably a lost cause. Never mind. It's basically the same as the picture that we have of ordinary twister space, where you've got a region in the middle, which is you can realize it, you know what this means in terms of ordinary geometry. And then on the outside, you've got these two non-commutative geometry. So it's this picture up here, really. And what the local twister does for you is to give you a tangent space here. So it sort of tells you a tangent space to the complex structure that would be there. And it also contains the commutation rules, at least locally, on the space. Now, there's a sort of conjecture I have here, which looks plausible, but this whole subject needs theorems, which is that there is a kind of analytic continuation into a genuine non-commutative holomorphic space. Everything is all analytic, and so it looks plausible that this should define a unique holomorphic non-commutative geometry on this side, at least locally, and that would happen on the other side too. But that's conjectural at the moment. I don't know if that's true for sure. But that would be the basic idea. And the converse of that, suppose you know this non-commutative geometry, at least in the neighborhood of the space N, that would be the twister description of your space-time. How do you get back to your space-time? How do you recognize the points in the space-time? Well, this is pretty clear. How you would recognize the points is you look for subspaces, C2s, complex two-dimensional spaces. I can't see where I've written it because it's upside down, but maybe you can see it. And those C2s would give you complex points. If those C2s are actually real in the sense of the complex conjugation rule, then they would give you real points. So the points of the space-time would be identified by these C2s, which are commuting C2s, within the non-commutative algebra of the space-time. Okay, so that's the picture. Number of conjectural aspects, but it does seem to me it has a reasonable chance. Let me make two further comments. That is only constructing a Riemannian, pseudo-Riemannian Lorentzian space-time. So the conjecture here is that this type of non-commutative geometry is equivalent to pseudo-Riemannian four spaces, or Lorentzian four spaces. How about the Einstein equations? Now, remarkably, the Einstein equations are almost trivial in this thing. Because when you have local twister transport, this is something I never knew what to do with for a long time. You find that these infinity twister objects, whether you have a cosmological constant or not, that's the lambda, one of these is just the dual of the other, these things are, in the Einstein, if and only if Einstein's vacuum equation holds, these things are completely constant over the whole local twister space. So what you would have as representation of the Einstein equations in this formalism is that these I objects, well, just one of them is all you need, is given to you. It's constant, the local twister transport preserves it, and then you would expect to see the Einstein equations everywhere. So it's very remarkable, I find, how simple the expression of the Einstein equations is, though all the difficulties are in the framework. But once you've got the framework, the Einstein thing sort of flops out. A couple of points here. The I's give you a kind of complex symplectic structure. So it's kind of intriguing here that maybe, and this is more where perhaps it relates to the thing Shah Majid was saying this morning.
Equations?
No, these are the full Einstein equations. I'm so sorry, I should have made that quite clear. All the way through.
Okay.
Right from the very beginning when I was talking about the contour integrals, after that, everything after that is the full Einstein equations. Nonlinear. Yes. No, the linearized ones we already know how to do from the cohomology. No, this is the hard stuff. Now, you see, here's a crazy succeeding. You see, everything I've been saying is a funny way of doing classical geometry. It is classical space-time. However, there are a lot of quantum features to this, and so it rather suggests that it might be a jumping-off point for a quantum gravity proposal. Now, there's a sort of obvious thing that one might think about, and that is, you see, I've been talking about this commutation rule here, which is for the whole framework, but what about doing the similar kind of thing for the Zs with themselves? So this is a bit like what Shyamajeev was talking about, where you have positions which don't commute with each other. Now it's the twisters not commuting with themselves. Now whether these have to be combined with these or whether you can separately postulate both, I don't know. But it seems to be a very natural suggestion, particularly when there's a cosmological constant, because when there is a cosmological constant, as we believe there to be now, because of the exponential expansion of the universe, which seems to be observed, then these things are actually giving you a complex symplectic structure. So you've got this one, you've got this one, and do you quantize all of them, or do you have some combination of them to quantize? And I don't know the answer to that. At the moment, this is just a crazy thought, but it does seem to me within this framework, it's certainly a very natural thing to do if you're trying to find some kind of a quantum gravity scheme. And that's very much, much more speculative than anything I've said up to this point. Thank you very much.
Any question?
So one question, which I don't know if you've considered it, but before you go to the curve case, you could consider your last bit of non-commutative flat Minkowski space.
Yes.
And there are proposals going back to the 1990s for exactly what that is. In fact, the enveloping algebra of the quantum Lie algebra of quantum SU2, is exactly a very natural Q-Minkowski space. It has the time direction is the trace, just as it is in classical case, and the determinant is the metric, just as it is in the normal picture of Minkowski space as 2x2 Hermitian matrices. So this picture works very nicely, and you do have sort of that side of things. But yes, the differential structure, which is probably relevant to you, hasn't really been fully explored, and the twister interpretation hasn't been explored as far as I know.
Yes, so, well, maybe that sounds as though it could be very closely related to this. And you're completely right that you could go back to the Minkowski case, and you do have a perfectly good non-commutative geometry. It's a very canonical one, and it's a rather trivial one, I suppose you might say. But nevertheless, yes, you've got that non-commutative.
Well, what I have in mind is very non-trivial, but mathematically very nice. So that's the 2x2 braided Hermitian matrices. So it's
very
natural.
Well, I'd have to look at
and
that exactly.
It has a Lorentz group, Q Lorentz group action on it, etc. It's all been worked out.
But does that do something non-trivial to it, the Lorentz?
Well, I don't know about the twister picture, so that yes, would need to be developed, I think.
Yes. Well, when I say it's trivial, all I mean is that you just write it down.
No, there are lots of cues everywhere.
I have a nasty feeling it might be different. but still, it'd be worth looking at.
What's the difference from your point of view, not from
Einstein equation,
but from
non-self-dual
young
males? Yes. Well, of course, the Gouli issue has been holding up. the application of twister theory to particle physics in many ways. I mean, people do use twister theory in high-energy interactions and so on, but this is all very perturbative. What we do here is non-perturbative. That's part of the point of it. You actually...
So is your approach applicable to constructing young Mills?
Oh, yeah.
Not self-dual young Mills, but flat space, so how to get better?
Yes, it would be. I haven't thought about it much, mainly because I have been concentrating on the gravitational case.
But it should be easier.
Yes, it should be easier. Yeah. But I always thought that the Einstein equations, to me, are easier because I can see what they mean. Whereas often, I can see they should. It's certainly most people's attitude that Yang-Mills is easier than Einstein, and quite a reasonable point of view, I think. But it's more, I think, in a way, doing something which is, in a sense, more difficult is something easier or more likely to give you the right answer because of the constant. I'm probably contradicting myself here, but in the case of Einstein equations, one is forced. Although I must say I was only more relatively recently, within the last few years, seen myself being forced into it. But the Yang-Mills was a big part of the motivation, because there has been a long time ago a program for particle physics within twister theory, which sort of got stuck, and I think largely because of the Googly problem. And that googly problem has its just as bad features in the Yang-Mills case as in the Einstein case. So, yes, this approach should also tell you what to do in the case of Yang-Mills. And then maybe one can go back and see whether what Twistor theory has to say about particle physics. It would be very interesting. And I think that could be important, yeah.
The last one. I just wanted to see it. Yes, I don't have to. Thank you. That's all.
The bottom part, probably. You need it. That's another point about this. You need a number somewhere in the theory which is extremely small or extremely big. Because gravity, as compared with particle physics, this is a huge factor. We've got numbers of the powers of 10 to the 20 coming in. And it seemed to me you need, if this theory is going to make any sense, you've got to have a number somewhere which is either very big or very small. And here it would probably be very small. But I haven't followed that up. You need place. Another way of putting it is, what I said before, quantum gravity, for the very simple reason that there is no place for the Planck length. Whereas if you put these other commutators in, then there is a place for the time. And this, in terms of ordinary physics, is a very tiny business. And if you feed that into the theory with some pure number here, then maybe you can expect to mirror that aspect of physics. But I haven't explored that.
Yes?
This,
of course, comes to gravity. Could you tell us about the dynamics? I mean, usually for a work in the quantum theory, there is a sort of principle which in relation to the classical and the quantum, you're working on.
Well, usually you have a Lagrangian or something, or field equations. But you see, the field equations in the linearized fields come out automatically. So it's just from the fact that you have the cohomology in the Twistor space, and the dynamical equations come up.
And the second issue, maybe, is that in this approach, what would be the role of time, in the sense that in the dynamic you have the time evolution, but you have the time evolution, you need a global time somehow, or...
Well, of course, it's Lorentzian, or it's relativistic, so there is no time singled out. And one has to think of the dynamical equations as being space-time equations. But they do evolve in a causal way. So if you take a space-like surface, they evolve from that into the future. So it's just like ordinary physics, or ordinary relativistic physics. Now, when you have a quantum physics and... You see, I have a perspective on quantum gravity which is non-standard. My perspective tends to be a bit non-standard, which is that the theory is not going to be a quantum theory in the conventional sense, because quantum theory needs help. Now, this is not the standard view, but it seems to me, at least to a mathematician, one ought to say, well, you know, you've got unitary evolution as part of quantum mechanics, and you've got the measurement process. Well, they're inconsistent. Measurement is not unitary. So how do you get something non-unitary out of something which is totally unitary? Well, you're either driven off into many worlds and have some funny way of interpreting what's going on, which is where you have to go if you don't want to change it, or if you really want to describe the world we see, not some superposed world of alternatives, then you've got to change the theory. And it's not going to be unitary. And it's only not going to be unitary at a place, in my view, where gravity becomes involved. And I think there are good reasons that the principles underlying general relativity, in particular the principle of equivalence, and this is an explicit thing, you just can see is not consistent with the normal superposition principle in quantum mechanics. So there's got to be some give. Now, people might usually say, well, the give has got to be in general relativity because quantum mechanics has all this support, and, well, general relativity is extremely precise, but the number of experiments are very small and give you this precision, but it is extremely precise, at least as precise, probably more even, than quantum mechanics as we know it, but a rather limited number of things to measure it by. Now, it seems to me there's got to be give on both sides. I'm prepared to accept that something funny happens at first tiny, tiny distances, but I also believe that something funny happens to quantum mechanics when you have sizable masses involved, where you actually have to worry about the effects of the curvature of space-time. And this is rather an optimistic view because it is much closer to current experiment. If you're going to see what's going on at 10 to the minus 33 centimeters, that's hopeless. But if you're going to see what something is going to go on with just a tiny superposition, which is the sort of thing people are doing now in actual experiments, and you might see a difference. And this would be an indication of somewhere where the effects of general relativity are starting to impinge on quantum mechanics. So I would not expect, at least from my perspective, I might be wrong, but I wouldn't expect that this would be a quantum gravity theory in any conventional, whatever that means, sense of a quantum theory. It will be something where the state reduction would have to be part of the theory. Now, that's a long shot, but at least this is a different way of looking at it. And the dynamics is built in. And maybe that dynamics will tell you something about reducing states when they reduce. That would be the wild hope.
It's not working, so you need to speak.
I have a question about the Lyman-Penrose formalism. Is this formalism something to do with the Twistor theory, or is it something independent?
It's not very specific to twisters. It's to do with the spinner formalism. I mean, the spinner formalism predated the twist. Well, it was due to Infeld and van der Verden, really. The spinner formalism, not used much in general relativity, but I sort of took it over and used it a lot. And it's very useful in certain problems. It brings certain things. Yeah, it's very useful, that's right. And there is something about, Ted Newman found this curious relationship between complex transformations and the Schwarzschild to the Kerr solution, which needs, I think, still needs some understanding, and is related to twisters, because you certainly have twister things which do relate to Kerr black holes. You have invariants which you come from the twister formalism, and you can see these quantities are to do with helicities along light rays and so on. And that's, I believe it's something people use now in observations. But it's not the full-blown twister theory. It's a particular application which you can do because the Kerr solution is very specific. But if you want to try and use twisters in general relativity, you're going to have to use something like this that I've been talking about now. And that has not been done, and certainly not in the NP formalism, which was, as I say, predated twisters, and it's using the power of two component spinners, which is something which can be very valuable. Well, people with in the early days of supersymmetry, people used things very much like this. I don't know if that's what you're referring to. people use Zs for lots of different things. And if it wasn't twisters, then it's probably not so connected. But as I say, the early days of supersymmetry, conformal supersymmetry, the generators were in fact twisters. But they had different commutation. I mean, they wanted to make it supersymmetric, whereas here, if I made my twisters supersymmetric, I would be stuck at the beginning because I want to perform holomorphic functions of them. And if they anti-commuted and had this problem, you'd be stuck right from the start. So these twisters cannot be interpreted as supersymmetry generators in the way that Wesson's amino did in the early days. But there is a connection with that stuff, yes. But you meant something else, I take it. Yeah. No, I don't know what that is, I'm afraid. But if they're not twisters, they're probably something quite different.
Any other questions? Last one.
Something not to directly related to twister. What about your claim that classical gravity has something to do with the collapse of the wave function?
Yes, well, that was the point I was just talking before. Yeah, I mean, I think, to be a little bit more specific to what I was commenting at before, if you think about, suppose you're thinking about doing an experiment on the tabletop, as experimental physicists do, and you wanted to take into consideration the gravitational field of the Earth. Now, there are two ways you could do it. One is the way they probably would do it, namely Newtonian, and you would just put a term in the Hamiltonian to account for the gravitational field. Now, the other way is the Einsteinian way. You say, no, you pretend you have a falling frame, and there is no gravitational field, and then you transform back. Now, these two things only differ by the wave functions of each differ by a phase factor. So you might say, well, who cares? One's equivalent to the other. But if you look carefully at that phase factor, you see it has a term, e to the something which is cubic in the time. And what that means is that the two approaches actually are working in different vacua. So your quantum field theory is not the same. Now, you might not care as long as you're just working with one field. But suppose you're working with a field which is a superposition of two gravitational fields. So you have a lump of material here superposed with that lump over here. Then the gravitational field of that will be a superposition. And if they involve different vacua, you're cheating. So the question is, you're cheating if you use the Einstein view. If you use the Newtonian view, you don't see anything. If you use the Einstein view, and that's what I would adopt here, because the precision we know in general relativity is extraordinarily precise, I'd say, yes, use the Einstein view. Then you have a trouble, because the two different locations of that gravitating object give you two situations where you have to consider different vacua. And therefore, strictly speaking, you're not allowed to make superpositions. So you're in trouble with your quantum field theory. Now, my position is, well, you're in trouble, but maybe you won't notice it for a while. And you can estimate how long it takes before the trouble causes real trouble. And that gives you a time scale. So I argue that a superposition between a mass in one place and in another place will have a lifetime which you can calculate from the difference in the mass distributions. And that lifetime is something which people are involved in trying to experiment. There, Dick Baumeister in Santa Barbara and in Netherlands has been doing experiment for over a decade now, which these things take a long time, but which he hopes in a few years might actually detect the... What you have is a little mirror which is displaced by about the diameter of an atomic nucleus between two locations, and they're in quantum superposition. But the theory says that in a matter of seconds to minutes, that should become one or the other. And so that's measurable. And that would be very interesting to see if that... And that arises completely from a conflict between general relativity and standard quantum mechanics. And the question is, does this conflict begin to show itself up in the way that... It's a rough estimate, so I wouldn't want to base too much on the actual figures here, but they should see it. Yes, this is the collapse. See, the mirror is here and here at the same time. It's part of, it reflects a photon backwards and forwards, and this photon gives it a kick. And so it hits it about a million times, and that moves it. And so that photon is already one of a pair. The photon has been split into two beams. One beam is doing this. The other beam is somewhere else. And then it will move the mirror. The part which is in the other place, the mirror is already not moved. So the mirror is in two places at once. And will it stand that, or will it become one or the other? If it becomes one or the other, you should see a loss of coherence in the experiment. This has not yet reached the level at which they will see this effect, but it's not so far off. So maybe in a few years.
We stop here, but it looks like that identify collapse of the wafer just deteriorates.
But that's not what I'm doing, you see. Yes. I mean, that's the standard view. The standard view is sort of interesting because there's discussions I was having with people here before with the view of a Lagrangian system. You say, can you treat it as something which there is a Lagrangian for the whole system? Or doesn't that really work because things have friction and so on? But then you say, no, friction is only just other particles involved in the system. When you take everything into account, it is a Lagrangian system. Now here, I think it's the opposite. Because people usually say, very often, they say, okay, the reduction of the state comes about because of the environment being involved in the system. Now this is a case where they are being extremely careful that the environmental decoherence is not there. You have to put it very low temperature, you have to keep a very good vacuum, you have to have the suspension, and so that there is no significant decoherence in the system. But still, the claim would be that you do get a state reduction. The claim is also that when there is decoherence, it's the same phenomenon, it's just that it's in the random environment. So when there's enough movement in the environment, the state will reduce because of the environment. Because there's always a problem with environmental decoherence. You say, well, it's the environmental decoherence, but you don't have a consistent picture of where those degrees of freedom have gone. And it's hard to make full logical sense of that. So I have a problem with the standard decoherence view. Seems to me it's got to be something more than that. But I mean, obviously one has to consider that, and it's an important part of whatever is going on, it's an important part of it. Yes.
Okay, well, let's finish here and thank
Thank you.
Before we finish, Pierre has a word to say, but it's not working.
Oh, okay. We use my box. Okay, so I remind you that this room is full of ghosts. And this institute was created in the intention of bringing Einstein here in Paris when he had to leave Germany. That was the first intent. Well, it was not so, but another refugee came, which is Volterra. Volterra has been ousted by Mussolini from all this position in Rome, and he found a shelter here, and most of his important books were the result of lectures he gave in this room or the next room. So it's full of gold. And not to mention the Duke of Louis de Broglie, who was also in this place for a number of years. So I think it was proper to have this conference in this room, in this place, at least in this lake. Because I think that we see that the debate about what is the real nature of gravity, Einstein gravity, what is the real nature of quantum mechanics, the debate is still with us. And what I've listened in these 5 days, well, I was not here for, I was only here for 3 days, but for these 5 days, is that the debate is still very lively, and that all this contribution here provided some step towards these big problems. The big problem is, what is space? What is space? And we have seen that, of course, the conjunction between, rather unexpected conjunction between Grothendieck's idea on the one hand and Einstein's and other physicists' idea, as can be still fruitful. And maybe in 10 years from now, we will have a better view of what is space. Thank you.